Three wars, 8, 9, 10 battles, moved material, moved men, kind of a watchdog, kind of a Gunga Din. The Henrico's job was to get to its assigned spot and get its troops in the boats. The engineers got you there, the gunners made sure you had a little bit of protection, the navigators figured out the route, but when you got there, that's the heart of the ship. Get those troops on the beach.
She was born of necessity as the United States was thrust into war, part of the fastest buildup of military might in history. The ability to move troops quickly to many fronts, across vast oceans and to the beach's edge was crucial to victory. From the beaches of Normandy through Vietnam, her military career spanned 25 years. She was the attack transport USS Henrico. The men who sailed her risked their lives to defend America's freedom and along the way helped chart the history of the 20th century. This is their story.
This was my first naval engagement. We pulled in this, we came down from Scotland. We went in this little harbor, not but a seawall around the thing. The ships were tied 2x2s, 4 1/2, all the way around the harbor. The second week we were there, the Germans started bombing us. They come across the English Channel about just over the water's edge. They get near the seawall and then they elevate, and that's when the radar gang could pick them up. But they were on us when the radar picked them up. Everything they dropped for that 7 nights, they never hit a ship in Weymouth. Never hit a ship.
The invasion force waited only for word from Allied Force headquarters.
When Eisenhower was trying to determine what day we were going in, because he knew Hitler was wise to it, we had put a special radio circuit. And whatever came over that speaker, we were to report to the commanding officer and the communication officer. Well, on June evening of June the 4th, mailbox, mailbox, mailbox. So we told Captain Wilson, he said, that means we leave in 24 hours. You don't find that documented anywhere about mailbox. Every ship in the harbor was waiting for this word, and when we heard mailbox, we knew we were leaving the next day.
Well, everybody knew it was going to be something big. Well, we all figured it was going to be across the channel, but we didn't know for sure where, because we had had 2 maneuvers before, and we'd started right for the coast and then cut down the channel, made it and come down, and they landed, and then they'd come back. We went on to Scotland. So the third time, we didn't turn back. We knew that was it.
We knew when the final one come up because they sealed the ship and nothing went off. So we said, this is it, you know.
Once the Air Force had started our bombarding in the middle of the night, that's when the adrenaline started pumping up. They had so many fires on the beach that it almost illuminated our ship. We're about 10 miles out. They just made round and round and round until they thought they had everything softened up. And we had breakfast like 2 in the morning. We loaded the boats around 4, and we knew that the landing wouldn't be till 6 or 6:30, and here these poor guys on these 150 boats in our division, diesel fumes, seasick. I still wonder this day, how many guys were able to leave those boats, and how much water were they in when they left the boats?
Now, they got in the boats, and then they just circled, sometimes for hours, until all the ships had gotten all of the first wave over the side in the boats and were organized. And then they all had little walkie-talkies and they were told to head up on the beach. And I don't think anybody went on the beach they were supposed to go on. Time and tide.
Well, it was rougher than anything I've ever seen them launch in the boats, as far as that, even in maneuvers in the wintertime. But the crew did a great job and they launched them all and went on about getting them in there. But a lot of the soldiers, they told me later, got really seasick.
The water was very rough, yeah, I mean. In fact, it was so rough that the waves were coming over into the VPs and the bilge pumps couldn't handle it. And the crewmen said that the soldiers had taken off their helmets and they were all bailing to keep the water out. I mean, it was that bad, I mean, before they got to the beach.
We knew there was a mess going on. We knew there had to be a lot of death for all the junk they had in the harbor and the height of the tide. We knew these boats was going to get busted up when they went in. We knew there was going to be a lot of troops drowned because they had their full field packs. When you step out in maybe 4 foot of water and you don't have your footing, what are you going to do? You're going to struggle.
As all of that was going on, it was routine. These guys had been trained, as I said, day and night. You get sick and tired of it. Why am I up at this ungodly hour? And it was routine.
Now, board the ship, there's a lot of tenseness because you've got people down in the troops in their quarters. You're putting boats in the water, and they're coming up to get into the boats in the order they're called.
They knew. Hey, we're going in for some real action. They knew this. Nobody was happy about it. And they knew that what their odds would be. When you're in the infantry, you say, well, let the good Lord keep me as long as he can. But if I get hit, make it quick. And that was our attitude. And our attitude, too, if we got hit on the ship, make it quick.
Now, for the troops, it wasn't routine. Going over the side, it wasn't the best day in the world out there on June 6th. That little boat down there, and it's little to the guy that's got to climb into it, he hopes he doesn't fall into it. That was the difficult part, just getting them in the boat. Once they were there, the boat crews knew what to do. And then there's so much confusion from that moment on that it's hard to really imagine what's going on.
With 1,400 men on board, there was no room on deck to load everyone at once into the ship's 25 landing craft. So the men, elements of the 1st Division, the famed Big Red One, remained below the Henrico's deck, awaiting the call.
Then we had to come down these ropes into the landing crafts of the LCVPs, which were bobbing crazy 15 feet of water, shaking up and down. A couple of guys fell in and drowned with the full field pack. They couldn't get them out, they just sank with the heavy load that they carried on their backs.
Well, we had about at least 36 men on board. And, they were talking, and it was rough. It was a rough ride. And I guess all of them got seasick. And of course, when they got seasick, they threw up into the boat because it was quite windy, and we got quite a spray coming over the bow.
The guys that went in had never been in battle before. They had to hunt around and find veterans from Salerno, Anzio, Sicily, North Africa, and they had to find guys and bring them in and make them the leaders.
I was in the North African campaign and saw death and destruction there to a minor degree, and then through the Sicilian campaign. But it wasn't until D-Day that overwhelming fear takes over. We got onto this particular LCVP, and I looked around, and I saw maybe 25 of us had the 1st Division patch on. And I looked at the other soldiers, and I didn't recognize the patches. I looked around, and I could tell the way they were talking that they weren't fearful. They had no fear whatsoever.
They wanted them just that way. They wanted them so green because the planners knew it was going to be one bad day.
As we got nearer to the beach, the shells came over, heavy shells, trying to hit whatever was coming in. And based upon our experience, the 1st Division guys intuitively hit the bottom of the deck for protection from the boat that we were in. And I happened to glance up, and one or two of them said, hey, that sounds like the 4th of July. And they got up on the Jeep. And I knew immediately, intuit, a shell was coming close. I could, from the experience I had in Africa and Sicily, I could tell you where that shell would hit, 50, 25 or close by. I knew this was close. and it hit close and decapitated one of them and wounded the other very badly.
The first wave didn't hear the noise of the battle on the beach because the battle on the beach was between the big guns in, at sea and the guns in the Germans had. Germans had huge guns sitting on that, sitting up on, I'm talking about Omaha Beach, about 100 feet up.
The battleship Texas was on the other side of us, and the cruiser Brooklyn. They start firing their heavies. Well, you can look up and see the projectile heading in the beach. You hear the bang from the gun. It sounded like a freight train. Then all of a sudden you hear a bang somewhere.
I mean, we hit them with bombs and didn't do a thing. The walls were seven. The bunkers had 7 foot thick walls with rebar, reinforced steel. It's about an inch in diameter and it's laid in there. It's webbed, welded, and they pour and then they do it and they pour. Bombs hit there, didn't do a thing. Did not do a thing.
Those bunkers were in and in tight.
It took a guy with a grenade or a flamethrower to finally put it out. You know, you had to walk up and knock, almost. Once the battle began, once the guys got on the beach, the next wave coming in heard it. Oh, Lord, did they hear it.
The machine gun just rattled. It just kept hitting the side of it. And when the ramp did come down, I saw several of them get blown out of the water. They had direct hits. They went right up 10, 15 feet water, all of them. And some of them were large landing craft tanks that had trucks in them. That blew them right out of the water.
Of course, those 88 shells coming at us, and they were exploding left and right, and back and forth. And that, naturally, we didn't get hit with one of them, which is good.
When the bombardment came on the landing craft that I was in, remember we were seasick, and when you're seasick, you can't pretty much think only about throwing up and vomiting and where you're throwing up. Remember, we're shoulder to shoulder, and you certainly can't put your head over the boat. That you don't do. And the experience that we had, the past experience that we had, remember, as being combat soldiers, I can only think that my mind was not thinking about anything but how do I keep myself safe? Camouflage, camouflage, camouflage is what combat soldiers are trained for. When you hit the beach or anywhere else, you look for camouflage. The boat was our camouflage. When they hit, when the shells hit, the 10, 12 of my platoon automatically fell flat, and if somebody was underneath us, we fell right on top of him. That was what we thought of, how to protect ourselves.
I don't think we knew what we were headed for, to be honest with you. We knew there was a lot of ships around and boats and aircraft, shells going overhead, but we didn't realize that it was going to be such a tough landing. And I don't think we were scared. That's not the word, but I'm sure we were, whether we wanted to be or not. And when we left the men off, put the ramps down, and they went into the water, most of them were up to their waist. And we just left them there and backed out, and were lucky to get back to the ship.
And they're so sick, they couldn't have cared less. I mean it, they were sick, sick, sick.
And I was seasick myself. Remember, we're soldiers, we're not sailors.
Shaken and disoriented, the men stepped off the boats and the fight began, not for the beach, but for their lives. Some struggled for every breath.
Well, the only thing that bothered myself and my three other men Well, the fact that these GIs were stepping off into what was supposed to be not too deep, but it ended up they were deepening. We even thought, because we went over one sandbar to get in closer than we did, and so I hope they all made it. I'm not too sure.
Invasion planners used low tide to add to the element of surprise and to expose mines and obstacles. But the low tide also exposed sandbars, false beachheads. Under fire and frightened, many boat coxswains were tempted to use these sandbars as the end of the line, and many soldiers found themselves neck deep or worse as they faced a long trek to Omaha Beach.
They weren't supposed to open the ramp until they saw the beach tour, you know. And because we went over the first one, and our coxswain wanted to open the ramp, and we overrode him. The ensign told him, we got to get closer.
I worked with a guy for many years, and he said when that ramp went down, he didn't care what he had to go into. He was so glad to get out of that sewer that they had been throwing up in and wetting their pants in and get on the beach. And of course, he was in wave three, and when they got on the beach, everything he had, he'd lost. Because when he stepped off the ramp, they were way, way out. And he had almost his weight in gear that he had to bring in. So as Tom said, he said, I came ashore with the clothes on my back. And he said, you could go anywhere and pick up a gun. There were guys who would never use them.
About 5 minutes later, the ramp came down, and it came down on a sandbar. And we still had maybe, I don't know, 25, 35 yards to go to shore. And as I looked out, I saw these cross iron stanchions all around us, and bodies on top of them, and hundreds of bodies floating upside down with just the field packs visible.
And you know, they were all told, don't stop. Let your buddy lay there, we'll take care of him. Oh. Wow.
I saw a first division patch and I grabbed a body and I hauled it into shore as the guys were dying all around me. When I got to the beach, there was no camouflage to hide. There was not a rock, wasn't a tree. There was nothing, and I knew where the enemy was. They were only a couple hundred feet looking right down on us. We were sitting ducks in the water with 75 pounds of baggage on your back, and you're in the water. Even if you're up to here, you know how fast you can move. And I learned at one time, when you're under fire and there's no camouflage, you've got to do something drastic. And I dropped the body on top of some other men of my platoon, and I fell on top of them. And I laid there, I don't know how long, until a cry came from one of the captains. There was something to the effect that we're going to die on this beach, those who stay here, so let's get the hell off of this beach. A combat soldier is a hero, but mentally, he is not a hero. He's a victim. He's a victim of atrocities beyond human comprehension. He has a mind that takes a picture and leaves a negative. And when he's liberated, and if he makes it off the beach, out of the foxhole, and gets home, he's not free. He's not a free man.
When I first saw the first load of casualties come aboard the ship, that was my first recollection of what war is all about. When you see guys come in wounded as they were, face covered up, legs shot off, arms shot off, wrapped up in all kinds of bandages, that was my introduction to the war. We were equipped to load 300 casualties. We moved in closer. We had almost 300 casualties by 2 in the afternoon, and we left right away. Our job was complete, and normally we went back to Weymouth with the casualties. Our job was done. We went back to Scotland, because if we stayed there, we'd been away. All the traffic moving in and moving out.
D-Day secured the Normandy beaches and represented the Allies' first steps toward victory in Europe. The Henrico had done her duty and played her part extremely well.
We're proud of her. We went out of Normandy 10 days and we were a flagship. And that Henrico was a flagship the remainder of her naval career. You know what your ship can do. And you're briefed before the engagements. You know when, where, what, how, what is expected of you. And you're going to do that. And that was the attitude of the entire crew. We had a good ship and a good crew.
When you're in war, you live for the day, because you don't know if you're going to make it tomorrow. But the main thing is to trust your fellow crewmen and all your buddies, and keep your head up and you'll make it.
We're brothers. And we were together in some awful, awful situations. And we learned to depend on each other, and I think we still do.
Everybody depended on the other guy, and the other guy came through. If something happens to that ship at sea, you can't run next door and call the fire department. And it could be a long swim. So every man depends on the next fella to do his job so that you don't end up swimming or burning to death. And that's one of the things that makes a ship so tight. The ship is the mother, and the crew are the kids, you might say.
This crew was such a group of men that you would go anywhere in the world and do anything that was assigned to you. You would do it without any hesitation.
During the next months, the Henrico ferried more men and materials to France, Italy, and North Africa. She landed troops at the invasion of southern France. By October, her job in the Atlantic was done. Henrico set course for the Pacific. During late March 1945, she helped land elements of the Army 77th Division at the invasion of Okinawa on April 1, Easter Sunday. At twilight of the next evening, the Henrico would witness her darkest hour.
Oh my God, we've been hit. This was nothing new to us by now. My God, they got us.
It just went vroom. It was an empty feeling you had, and a big loud noise, and the officer next to me says, "We got it."
Chaos. disaster, damage, blown bulkheads.
The lights were out, you couldn't see anything, it was dark.
It seemed so eerie, so quiet. Yet the kamikazes were still flying over. They didn't stop just because they hit us.
Every one of our ships got damaged one way or another. We all got hit well.
It was Japs to the right, Japs to the left, Japs over, Japs coming down, and
bam, bam, bam. They got seven in our division that time, but they got seven of us in 20 minutes. We had no idea it was going to be our turn. But when it got us, my God, it got us.
It was like in a vacuum, like, I mean, sensation, I mean, for, I don't know, I suppose a second moment, but it seemed like it was a hell of a lot longer.
He came right into the superstructure, right into the bridge. Everybody that was there died on the bridge, including the skipper, everybody.
And some of the men here today were on a burial detail when they took them over to Zamami Island to bury them. They had an open trench. They laid them in that. They had a cross they stuck at the head of the grave.
Kamikazes were a constant menace as Japan lost its grip on the Pacific Empire it had amassed. Desperation mixed with a fearsome loyalty to their emperor led many young Japanese pilots to add themselves to the divine wind that was so feared by Allied shipping.
They knew that when the watches would change, when chow would be down, when water hours were on, we had to live on water hours for fresh water for showers and things like that. And they knew just send one plane or two planes. That's all it took to get the whole fleet back to general quarters. Sometimes it'd be 40, and the worst raid we had was 400. And we were general quarters for a couple, 3 hours on that. But the final total count was that there was 300 Navy ships either sunk or damaged in Okinawa. And I think there was a total of 6 destroyers came through unharmed.
One fellow that was right next to me here, I'd given him a pair of shoes, and he got blown out of my shoes, I mean. The next one to him, he had his wristwatch. The insides were blown out of his wristwatch, and he had shrapnel wounds in his back, you know, like.
And guys were standing on the deck wondering where it was gonna hit. They had no place to hide, no place to go. And you could hide behind the house, and the ship, the plane would go right through the house. And the poor guys in the engine room, oh, Lord, have mercy on them. When the ship took a hit, the guys in the engine room were as blind as bats, not because the lights went out, because they couldn't see. They could hear, but they couldn't see.
Whoop up. The ship reared up. Well, the guys in the afternoon, the ship, the afternoon went up too.
The noise itself was horrendous. The explosion, the plane hit, I guess. But that was it. And you know, I can't swim. So my buddies all gave me the Mae West life jacket, and they threw a Jacob's ladder over the side in case we had to go over. So, but the Navy couldn't teach me how to swim, so I'm not afraid of water. I'm afraid of being in the water. That's the difference.
When the kamikaze hit, right before it, I was sitting up talking to one of the guys that perished in it, you know. And I looked up at the clock and I said, I have 5 minutes or 10 minutes to take a shower. So I run back to my bunk on the fantail, and I just reaching for my towel when it hit. And that ship come up in the air about 3 feet. I thought we hit a mine. But I come up and that's when I saw what happened, you know.
Everything stopped. We stopped, the ship stopped. Fire was all over the place.
It was a pretty bad hit. And she survived, and the crew pulled them out of it.
You're so busy at the time, you don't have time to think.
Well, there was so much gunfire, you know, so you didn't really know who was shooting at what. And the destroyer probably was, but we were busy, so. We were trying to save our ship.
We had been trained to continue do our job and to take directions.
It's a great crew and a great ship. I mean, we wondered when we're getting all of these, trainings and so forth in the Chesapeake, why, because it got monotonous, but then I finally realized that the reason is so that when something happens, you don't think, you just act, And so you did enough of these things, and our captain was quite proud of the fact that we were so well trained.
Everybody knew where to be. Everybody knew what to do. And I found it both rewarding and somewhat humorous that these guys, that you might see them on the beach, that were so devil may care, if you will, and when that general quarter sounded, everybody knew what road to take to get to that one spot they were supposed to be. And it was training, training, training. And you get tired of getting up in the middle of the night, and you get tired of listening to the alarms going off, you get tired of a lot of things. But when you can do it in your sleep, then you can do it. And they did. And oh, I marvel at them, all of them.
Every sailor is proud of his own ship. You keep that ship clean, you keep that thing operating to the top efficiency, you know each other, you're shipmates.
On the Henrico, everybody knew their job and everybody did their job. And you knew the guy next to you was doing his job as well as you were. But you had faith in your crew members.
You just couldn't imagine your ship being destroyed like that. You just couldn't imagine, but it happened.
All I could see was smoke flying and people running and some of them staggering out of the smoke and stuff. And an officer, shortly after that, he grabbed me to go in there and fight fire.
When I got topside, it was sickening. The entire superstructure was in flame. And there was no way I was going to get to the radio shack. So some of the GIs were jumping over the side. He said, we told the guys, you don't jump unless your feet's wet. And our feet's not wet yet.
Some of them had no choice. They was blowed over the side. Because right along there where he hit, a lot of times them soldiers that time of the evening would line that rail. But a lot of them was blowed over the side.
Whether they were rescued or not, I have no idea.
A destroyer, he pulled in to fight fire. And there was sharks all through the water. And he had, they had rifles up there shooting at him.
We had a frigate come alongside, trying to put the fire out. Found out what we were carrying and left us. He was smart, right?
Because we had high octane gasoline and ammunition on board. Of course, we were burning in the middle.
We were loaded with TNT.
We had a bad list. And that's when they stopped. They used the bullhorn, I guess, and told them to back off.
They pumped so much water that we had a tremendous starboard list.
We were sinking, more or less, by our own hand, not knowing it. The fire main below deck was split in half. And the guy in charge of the fire pump, auxiliary fire pump, he started up. What the hell did he know? He didn't know that we were going to sink. So somebody got down to him finally and told him to shut it down.
I'm standing there trying to get this superstructure fire out with a bunch of men. Somebody on the bridge, this destroyer was in, close. You couldn't put your hands down between the two ships. He was in that close. And the bridge was right about where we were standing. Somebody on the bridge, the destroyer on the Hobson, take cover. So I dove up on the hatch and rolled underneath one of these landing crafts and looked up. And there was like two or three coming in for the final kill. I would say there was less than a dozen rounds fired from that destroyer. I didn't see anything else. They didn't make it. They didn't get to us. I mean, by this time, these gunners on these destroyers, they had plenty of practice. But he did. They dropped them. Because we were flamed, we were on fire, and they knew they could never come in for the final kill. So when they finally got the fires out, I realized, I don't even have my helmet on. Because I kept it up in the radio shack. It's getting dark, and I said, hey, I got to get a helmet. And I knew where I kept it, hanging in the overhead. It's dark. I start shuffling my feet along across the deck. Something told me, don't you take another step, turn around and get out of here. Now, we know who told me. A lot of people ask me, did you hear it verbally or how'd you? I said, I don't know. I heard it. Get out of here. So I crawled in one of the boats and got a helmet out of there. The next day we went in to clean up the shack. My helmet's laying over in the corner with a strap sprung under my chin strap. My gas mask and my K-pop was gone, but my footprints was just a matter of a few inches from where the deck was cut in half in the radio shack. If I take one more full step, I'm gonna be here telling you about it.
I guess we're all glad to be alive. I mean, you know, we had figured if we ever got hit with the cargo we had, with that TNT forward and high octane gas, we'd probably blow up into the air, you know. So that's what I was expecting, maybe.
We hated to get hit, but if we had to be hit, we'd rather been hit where we were. Because if he had hit fore aft, well, the whole ship would have disintegrated.
This is a shock to see your ship on fire and see the dead laying around. It's a terrible shock. But you have the feeling that we're not going to leave the ship. We're going to get this thing together and keep going. That was the general attitude. Hey, we're still afloat, we're going to stay afloat.
It was chaos for days after. I mean, not as far as the kamikaze, but cleaning up and getting things back in shape.
You could see what was left of the plane on deck. Most of us got a piece of it. We took shovels and shoveled the junk over the side. Remember in the Pacific, we got one remark from the troops. When you go and make a landing, you sailors can have those clean bunks. You sailors can have those three squares every day. And the 2 miles of ocean under you. That's what's the problem. There ain't no place to dig a hole. Because we had so many suicides banging us, they were actually glad to leave the ship.
It's almost unbelievable, the reason why, the beating she took. And still, she was able to do the job that she was built for. Henrico was not a combatant ship in that sense of the word. She took this tremendous beating, and amazing that she survived, really.
We couldn't write home about this, no way. The chief radio man came to the radio shack and he said, look, you know you cannot write home about it. See, during World War II, your mail was censored. You couldn't tell even the weather conditions you were under. You say, Mom, I'm doing well. I'm doing fine. Everything's going along good. The only way they knew we were in combat is when they written the paper. So when I finally got back to San Francisco, I wrote my mother a letter. I told her what happened.
I since read so much about the kamikazes that my opinions and these things have changed. At that time, I'd like to, you know, whatever you could do to them, you know. Boil him in oil, whatever, because I saw all this misery that he caused down there on all my friends, you know, and they killed him, you know. So he was responsible, but he was trained to do that. He was just doing his job in this case. I found out since, you know, I mean, since then I have, what do you want to say, mellowed but not forgiven.
The Henrico's crew nursed their ship back to San Diego for repairs and a refit. World War II, for them, was over. But the USS Henrico's journey had only begun, and her next course had already been laid. Operation Crossroads was the United States' first post-war attempt to come to grips with the awesome power of its nuclear capabilities. The Henrico was anchored outside of the many captured German and Japanese target ships parked near the blast zone. Wearing only goggles as protection against the blast's radioactive effects, the crew was among hundreds of sailors who witnessed the tests. The bombs were detonated on and near the tiny, newly evacuated island of Bikini.
I found a ship exciting at times. Oh, the rougher the sea, the more exciting I found it. Now, maybe as I got older, it got less and less exciting. But when I went to sea at 17, man, I thought that was exciting. Ooh, heavy seas. Heavy seas, it would come alongside and take your lifeboats away. You get up in the morning, went out on deck and said, ooh, we got a problem here. That to me was exciting. Taking the water over the bow, that was exciting.
I never did get seasick, but I sure got beat up a lot. I got slammed into the bulkheads, and in one case I was spun around in my chair and thrown out of it. You get a lot of bruises and you get hurt a lot. And you can imagine what it is if you're in a heavy weather and a small craft, how much they get beat up. So you just hope that everybody's got a hold of something and you're running and the thing doesn't sink.
In the engine room, you only hear the engine room. You may feel things, and we in the engine room feel a lot less than the guy on the bridge, because when you roll 30 degrees in the engine room, you know, you feel that. The guy on the bridge that rolls 30 degrees, he is hanging on something to hold his position.
Where I stood, my watch was four decks above the main deck. And up there, you know, when you winch, you went. And our chair used to slide from one side to the other. So they got smart and they welded hooks on the deck to keep us in place when the ship rolled. So that made it a lot better. The way that thing rolled sometimes, I didn't think we had a prayer coming back. But we were lucky.
Another day in the life of a ship at sea. That's about all.
On June 25, 1950, communist North Korean forces invaded democratic South Korea. Without warning, the invaders brushed aside the unprepared Republic of Korea defenses. The U.S. answer was an invasion force of nearly 70,000 men and 320 ships, including the Henrico. On September 15, 1950, the Henrico participated in landing elements of the 1st Marine Division, roughly 100 miles behind the North Korean lines at Incheon. The tides were complex and extreme, with low tides certain to leave the first waves of Marines cut off from reinforcement by a sea of mud. The landing was a success, and after Marines battled their way to take Seoul on September 25, the amphibious assault proved to be a decisive and brilliant tactical masterpiece. The attack split North Korean forces in two, cutting the main supply lines to North Korea. Incheon and the Henrico helped ensure the survival of a democratic and free South Korea.
The ocean roared on a distant shore back in December of 54. They found themselves in a bombed out city in a foreign land with 400 orphans close at hand. Was that you, Lord, in a sailor's hat? Tending those children with a hug and an encouraging pat? Was that you as a sailor, Lord, ensuring those waifs be served all this crew could afford? The white hats fed them and gave them treats. The vow was, the children have a great feast. Then the leftovers, the sailors eat. The Korean War had ceased and peace returned again to the Far East. The city was of A-bomb note. It was Nagasaki. These battle sailors had moored their boat. It was Christmastide, but these seamen had no families by their side. These sailormen in white hats did the next best thing. To the least of yours, Lord. Love, gifts, and food they did bring. Lord, does an act such as this gain a seaman eternal bliss? I'd like to think that by such a loving, compassionate act, the code to heaven these white hats did crack. 400 sailors from above deck and below, and surely that day earned their eternal halo. To that Henrico crew, 400 angels with whom I served, sailed anew. I often wonder how many are still alive.
In 1955, national policy and a humanitarian mission of epic proportions set the Henrico on a collision course toward what threatened to swell into an international incident.
The assignment was we would go in and take out refugees and troops.
Even at the height of World War II, pro-democracy Chinese troops fought a desperate battle against Maoist Chinese communists. After a decade of retreat, the pro-democracy forces were forced onto a handful of islands off the Chinese mainland. Eisenhower vowed to defend Taiwan, but the outlying islands made for dangerous diplomacy. Ta Chen, its ragtag force of defenders and scores of desperate civilians, faced imminent capture by Red China.
And I distinctly remember it coming over the PA. Tomorrow we may start World War III. And I thought, nice touch, really a nice touch, guys. I will really sleep well tonight.
We took aboard about 25 or 30 Chinese casualties that stepped on mines. And what we did, we called for the doctors and all the accompanying ships to come over, and we had a very, very good medical team. At the same time, you should have seen the sailors lined up along the side of the ship there, ready to give blood. We had about 200 of them, 200 guys just waiting to be called. You know, I need type A or type B or whatever they might want, and because they were having to take legs off, these guys, and it was some pretty well, you'd be proud of the guys, really.
And this was MASH to an nth degree. There was nothing there. I walked in to make sure, and I would ask, do you guys have all the power you need? Is everything working so I could get the hell out of there? And they're operating on a kid. And I don't think he was 16. And I looked at him, and I wondered, what in the hell is wrong? I went about my business. Now, sometime later, I'm back up making my rounds. And I hear, the ear and the mind are able to discern what is a correct sound. And the correct sound varies from ship to ship, so quickly the ear and the mind acclimate to that engine room. And if something went awry, you'd actually hear a different noise, and you'd start looking for the different noise. And this was a strange noise, so I began following it. That's not a noise we have. And as I'm walking, I'm getting closer, and it stopped, and I heard a thump, and I turned, and his leg was in a bucket, and the surgeon was there with the saw. And I thought, My God, my God. About 45 minutes later, I'm making my rounds, and I hear the noise, and I thought, oh, God. And I heard the thump. Oh, me.
More than 25,000 soldiers and 18,000 residents were rescued. China stood down, and the Henrico's mission was a success.
When you went to the Pacific, everything when the Henrico got there was down south. Something one must keep in mind, because today's sailors would be stunned. There was no air conditioning. You had wind scoops, and that was your cooling in the engine room. You know, you got up to 15 knots and you turn those scoops into the wind, and that was your AC down below. You know, you got a sea around you that's got a sea temperature in the upper 70s, sometimes in the 80s. And you got a sun that's as relentless as can be. And that steel deck has a tendency to absorb all of that and pass it through. If you didn't have gloves, you got rags. And use those when you were going down the ladder to get into the engine room. The railings were so hot you didn't want to hold them. It was hot. Unbelievable. And the guy out on deck was being broiled doing his day work out on deck. So it was a totally alien environment. And when you pulled into a harbor, there was nothing there, you know, the Nipa huts. Now there were places were built up, the French had ports down there, but nothing that we were accustomed to. The culture wasn't ours. You know, they'd give them R&R and put them on the beach and give them each two bottles of warm beer and tell them to have a good time.
No warm beer awaited Henrico's crew at their next port of call. In October of 1962, the ship played a walk-on role on the Cold War's most dramatic stage.
Shall be the policy of this nation to regard any nuclear missile launched from Cuba against any nation in the Western Hemisphere as an attack by the Soviet Union on the United States, requiring a full retaliatory response upon the Soviet Union.
The Henrico took its place in the U.S. blockade of Cuba. An invasion force of Marines waited below deck.
I call upon Chairman Khrushchev to halt and eliminate this clandestine, reckless, and provocative threat to world peace and to stable relations between our two nations. I call upon him further to abandon this course of world domination and to join in an historic effort to end the perilous arms race and to transform the history of man.
The Cuban standoff ended, but the historic effort to ensure nuclear peace remains the world's burden. In 1967, Henrico answered the call one last time to serve her country. Deckhouse 5 capped a career of honorable service. On January 6, the ship participated in the first major deployment of U.S. military might in the waterlogged rice fields of Vietnam's Mekong Delta. Henrico helped put ashore more than 4,000 Marines.
Henrico was there to provide the troops to put ashore, and we put them ashore in the old traditional way with a landing craft. But they weren't fighting their way ashore, let's put it that way. But we took all the same precautions.
U.S. and friendly Vietnamese forces found few enemy and reported only 21 Viet Cong casualties.
From my standpoint, a good many of the landings were almost administrative. Of course, we covered them with helicopters and all that. We did the routine things, but it wasn't really what you'd call a combat landing.
The horizon for the USS Henrico was in sight. She departed Vietnam late in March 1967 and returned to San Diego the following month. The Happy Hank was decommissioned February 14, 1968, and placed in reserve.
You've got to stand in awe of what it's been able to do, and all the different people who have been able to do it. A ship is a is much more than a thing.
That ship was home. It sure was. Never thought I'd miss a military barracks or whatever you want to call it so much, but I've actually missed the Henrico.
It's a love you have for your ship. Like I say, it's your home, you know what that ship can do. You know what the crew can do. And you're going to do it. You're not going to drag your feet on anything. You're going to do it. And we did.
Everybody was happy. Henrico Hank. The Happy Hank. That's the nickname.
She was a good ship. She was never a disgrace to the United States Navy. Never.
I personally feel that I learned more seamanship on that ship than anywhere else in my rest of my career. The basic seamanship was right there. I learned it, and I was able to use it throughout. And it's just a good ship. It always was a good ship. They didn't call her the Happy Hank for nothing.